end of the last film in Bangladesh, we saw a final shot of a tray dryer which is being used to solve their problems of drying in the rainy season or when it's very humid and the solar dryers are not efficient enough to work. And here we've got a model of the tray dryer, which essentially consists of a heat source on this side, which can be diesel fired or gas fired, and that blows hot air. The model should in fact have a chimney here, because you don't want the products of combustion to pass into the product. The hot air then blows into this chamber at the bottom and rises up through the stack of trays which you can see inside here. The trays are entered through doors at the front. Now, quite clearly, the tray at the bottom, which is being fed with hottest air, driest air, will dry first, and the tray at the top of the stack will dry last. So it would be very nice if we could find a way of removing that bottom tray, lowering all the trays down, and putting a new tray of fresh material in the top when the bottom trays dry. And this is in fact what the design of DryIt that ITTG is working on does. We have a mechanical lifting system here of trays. By pulling this large lever above, the second tray up and all the trays above it rise in the air. That allows you, through a small door at the bottom here, to remove that bottom tray of dry material, lower the lever, they all fall downwards, and a fresh tray of wet material is put in the small door at the top. They're normally a 15 trays inside the box. The objective of this video is in fact to try and help people who wish to construct one of these dryers around some of the perhaps the more difficult little bits to understand on the drawings. The basic construction is very simple: angle iron, etc., clad on the outside with plywood all the way over. And the next part of the video concentrates on the more difficult areas, particularly the way things are jointed, the way the lifting mechanism works, which is basically lifting these four rods, at the bottom of which are four little fingers which go up and down and move the trays. These are the critical and only critical part of the whole piece of equipment, and this is why the video concentrates quite a bit on the construction of the trays, which have to fit within fairly tight tolerances between those lifting fingers. Other than that distance across the width of the tray, where the lifting finger can rise up and pick up the next tray without touching this one, that is the only critical point in the whole system. So now we move on to have a look at some of the actual methods of construction.
The steel framework for the tray dryer is in fact made from three separate frames which are bolted together. There is a base frame and an end frame which you can see here bolted together in the foreground, and just behind it you can see the outer frame. The frames are made from angle iron which should be cut before assembly, ensuring all joints are neatly made. Initially, on assembly, all the joints should only be tack welded in position. This will allow you to ensure that all the joints are correctly positioned, after which they can then be fully welded. It is important to ensure that all external weld is cleaned up using either an angle grinder or a chisel. This will ensure there is a good, clean, flat surface for the other frames to be bolted to them. It is also useful to clean off the weld on other welded joints to ensure that the weld has penetrated the joint properly and a good strong joint has been made. Here you can see the outer frame bolted, not welded, to the base frame. It is important that the doors fit correctly. The best way of doing this is to make the doors and tack weld their joints together. Fit them to the frame to ensure they are fitted correctly, and if this is so, then fully weld them up. Once again, clean off all the weld on the joints using an angle grinder. If this is not available, then a hammer and chisel will do. Once the doors have been made, it is possible to assemble them into the frame properly. You do this by clamping them in position, ensuring that the doors fit and there is clearance all the way round. Once you are happy with this, it is then possible to weld the hinges in position. Here you can see a shot of the various pieces used in the lifting gear, the most important item being the lifting fingers. It is very important they are all made to the same size and dimension. The best way of doing this is to bolt them all together and then cut them to size and file them to the correct shape. Here we can see the lifting handle. And here are the various lifting bars which operate between the cams and the lifting fingers. The square plates are the bearing plates, and below which are situated the cams. Here you can see the two split bearing blocks, and here the four solid bearing blocks. It is important when assembling the lifting fingers that you clamp everything in position so that some adjustments can be made. One of the camshafts should be fitted in position with the bearing blocks and the lifting bars fitted to the fingers, with the joint between the two lifting bars clamped in position. Once this has been done, the cam connecting rod can then be bolted in position. It is only necessary to do the nut and bolt up hand tight at this stage. The cam shaft for the opposite side can now be assembled. The first job is to bolt the cam connecting rod to the cam on this side of the framework. Once again, the nut and bolt only needs to be done up hand tight. Once the cam connecting rods are in position, it is time to fix the bearing blocks. As you can see, the split bearing block fits in the center of the camshaft. This allows easy fitting. Once the blocks are in position, the remaining lifting rods and fingers can be bolted together. You can now adjust the fingers to ensure they're always in the horizontal position and then bolt the lifting rods together. Once this has been done, check the complete arrangement to ensure everything is firmly clamped in position.
The construction of the tray. Each tray has six compartments. Two of these are for air circulation and have no mesh. When using the tray dryer, the ends without mesh are fitted alternately in the cabinet to get a zigzag airflow. The most important aspect of the tray is the width. The trays must be narrow enough to drop cleanly when the bottom tray has been removed, yet wide enough to be supported squarely by the fingers. We therefore recommend that the trays are not made until the metal frame has been built, and that two dummy trays are made from cheap wood, so that the dimensions can be exactly worked out. The cutaway. In this shot, the carpenter is seen preparing the cutaways. These allow the fingers to move back up to the horizontal. Having made all the necessary joints, the tray is then simply glued and nailed together, as can be seen in these shots. The finished tray and a close-up of the cutaway. The tray is finished off, and then short angle iron lengths are screwed to the four corners underneath the cutaway points. The angle iron prevents the fingers damaging the tray. Note that the angle iron will increase the width of the tray. The next stage is to fit the beading. Narrow, thin strips of wood are used for this. The main purpose is to support the tray inserts. However, it also strengthens the tray structure and makes the underside flush with the angle iron pieces. The four tray inserts are now constructed. They are simply made by sandwiching squares of strong plastic mesh between two squares of wood. Triangular wood pieces are necessary to strengthen the structure. Each finished tray insert should be checked to see that it fits each compartment.
Yeah.
Having made all 15 trays, the next step is to clad the inner frame with plywood. Then, four lengths of wood are fitted to the inside long walls of the cabinet. These guide the trays down squarely onto the fingers. They should be tapered at the top to make loading easier. Full details are given in the engineering drawings. Here, the completed tray dryer is undergoing a short trial. The bottom tray has been removed, the stack dropped, and a new tray loaded at the top.
This dryer is now on its way to Lesotho, where it will be used to dry asparagus. are now 8 countries, mainly in Latin America, using dryers of similar types of design.